Flight brought me from Milan to Dharamshala. And it was the first time in which I started to embrace a completely different population and completely different beliefs that was the one of the Tibetan community in exile. I learned that about that period, I don't remember much about how I was spending my daily life. What I remember were the teaching that I understood mentally, but to be honest, I was not able to make it mine. Maybe because after 2 years' time I was living there, I had to rush daily to start my new working daily, and the chaos of our beloved daily is quite overwhelming a person, the chaos, the noise and everything. So to be honest, those teaching that I learned mentally, I was not really able to make mine in my daily practice. And I started a life that was always in a rush. I started the life that the world of today bring us to have, that is a life in which we keep on running, having continuous challenges. We pass from a competition to another to be able to survive, not to excel, because in the majority of the case, while we are running, we just survive to be able to be in the same level of everyone else. It's a life that really pushes hard. It's a society that teaches us to keep on pushing for continuous development, personal and also government development. And didn't teach us what it means to be still, to be calm, to not only listen the voices coming from the outside, but to also listen the voice coming within, from our inner self. We live in a society that till a few weeks ago was a society that had scientific discovery every season and technological and industry discovery in a cadence of a month time, and taught us that whatever we were getting new, we should not actually be used of it because something new was immediately coming next. A life that goes so far. We lived in a society that was teaching us how to keep on running, till a point in which the world, a few months ago, decided completely, overnight, in a very brutal way, decided to stop. And the order that gave us was stay still, stay in your home. So can you see the completely different thing? From a side, we have the extreme of that for a lifetime, the society, the world taught us to keep on running, to keep on accepting new challenges, to overjoy of a beautiful thing happening in the present just for a matter of few hours, because after we had to start again proceeding another step of our life. And in a certain point, he just decided out of the blue to tell us, now you stay still. Now outside there is a situation for which your most valuable asset you have in your life, that is the health, if you don't stay still, can be compromised. So not only the fears that my health, without health, there is nothing else. My health could be compromised, but the order, the completely opposite order of what we were used to, stay still, don't move, stay home, be silent. And he did it with such a silence. From a day, everything was chaotic. The day after, the streets were empty. Everything was completely closed. Everything was completely locked. And not a noise could be heard. If I have to make a comparison, I believe that such a silence I did not hear when I was in the height of the Himalaya. Apart of that, can you hear me?
Yes, yes, please continue.
I lost you for a second. So a very different situation, a very extreme opposite have been coming place from a moment to another. How did I react? I'm going to be completely honest with you, even if this scared me, it's not easy to be. Despite of what the mask we use every day, the social, the image we overcast on our social or environment, in which we might seem strong, we might seem calm, we might seem stable. The reality is that when all this happened, the emotion I felt, the main emotion I felt, it was fear. I was scared. I was scared because I did not know when it would land. I was scared because I did not know if the space of my house would be enough for me. I was scared even, to be very, very sincere with you, I was scared even that my marriage was not enough. Living with a person, living with and loving a person while you have many other things outside,
Please mute yourself.
Please don't cross talk. Don't cross talk.
Let me mute all.
And
okay. I'll unmute Paula. Where is Paula? Okay. Mute.
Fear?
Yeah, it's okay. Please go on.
And the biggest fear I had, that I was not enough for myself. So I see all the empty space left by this changing that I even doubt to be enough for myself. And so it was at the beginning because I wake up one morning and I realized that the practice that the great Mother India taught me, and I was used to put in practice while I was in India, the gesture, my daily gesture, my daily communication within myself, I had completely abandoned it when I left India. When I reached in a new country, maybe because I had to build a new life, maybe because I had to be new, I had to get used to the new environment, maybe made me completely leave behind the gesture that for years have taught me to stay still while in the chaos. We know that our daily is madly chaotic. It's unrestless. It's a city that by color, by smell, by noise, never let you rest. And at the same time, while I was there, I used to be calm. I used to be able to manage to listen the external part, the external world, but at the same time, that quiet palpitation that comes also from the inside, the quiet voice that teaches from the inside. So I went back in my memories and I remember a monk telling me that to be able to be stable, a master was the discipline in my daily life. And for that reason, I decided in one day to start again to perform the gesture I was used to perform in India. I give you an example. In India, I used to wake up and I used to do yoga. 20 minutes, I'm not a great yoga master. I'm not very skillful, but I used to do yoga. I used to do my 20 minutes meditation. And then I would start my day. And so I started. Of course, when you start to re-embrace some gesture that you left behind, this doesn't mean that you go immediately back in the stage of mind in which you were. Notion. Over this year, I acquired so many Notion of any kind, but mentally I completely understood. But if I have to count them, the one I put in practice in my daily life, 5 is too much. The number of 5 is really too much. The one end is enough. But so I did. I started again. I started, while I started again, trying to get back in my silence, try to listen again what was coming within myself and not only from outside, I remember that I realized that the world teaches us, our world, our society has taught us to always look outside, to always be careful from the input that come from outside. But no one has never teaches us, at least in the West part of the world. In India, this situation is quite different. Unfortunately, nowadays, also the Indian contemporary society is very much focused on the West track, that it means outside, input outside, development, everything. But if you go down deep, India, in the traditional way, teach it as how to stay still and how to stay within yourself and how to also navigate a part that is the inner self that is without borders. The material thing has borders. It finish. If I take this book, it finish. In a certain point, after a little while, you cannot go over it. But some teachings that come from the East and not from the West, and I believe we should, it's time now to start to go and take them again out and start to go over them again, because it's the time, teaches us a territory that is completely endless. Saying that, I went back in my memory and I would like to read what a Tibetan nun taught me during the interview I was making when I'm for my thesis, for my university thesis. I collect different interviews from women, men, monks, children that escaped from Tibet and came in exile in India to be able to survive the Tibet situation of today. And I want to tell you her story that is full of tragedies, is really the hell on earth, is not such a comfortable tragedy as today one, in which we are still very comfortable. Is a real tragedy that my imagination cannot still grasp, even if I see picture, even if I hear testimonies. I'm going to read a piece of her interview in which, after telling me her story, she focused in giving advice to me about how to overcross these difficult timings in life that can be the coronavirus of today or any personal problematic situation we face in our life. She writes, "In addition to my story, I would also like to offer you something else, some advice. I would like to give you a precious key that I use to conquer the bitter tears. I am saying this so that others do not have to experience the most painful time in order to arrive at this simple truth. Always remember that even when you have experienced negative situation, this does not mean that you will never enjoy and cherish yourself. I see most people, especially those who, like you, travel from West, a desperate and periodic search for happiness that lies outside, in the material world, in the body. I see you lose yourself in the rage and the rancor of the past, or in an endless planning for the future, but never really stopping your quest and being content in the present. You seek so much outside of you without realizing that true tranquility starts from what we are now, in our present and in our spirit, not in buds that still have to bloom or in memories that no longer exist. How can one think of living anchored to what has already existed for some time or still has to sprout? How can one be convinced that happiness is not something that comes from the outside, work or economic well-being? It would take so little to understand that the exterior is not something to be counted on for a peace that resides within. If only we could look at things rationally without falling under the influence of emotion. There will always be other people who, whether they want to or not, will cause us suffering. There will always be new obstacles in our path. But how can we overcome new ones if we still dwell in past resentments? Our inability to overcome the challenges of life come from our reluctance to accept the truth that suffering is a part of our life. The secret lies only in letting go of excessive planning and a past that is no longer a part of us. It is good to view one's life as it is, as if it was a plain blue sky with random flashes of cloud that bring pain. The secret is to see the cloud and yet to dwell in the serene blue instead of dwelling of what could contaminate that sky. The key that I give you for happiness is the fact that everything depends on your ability to change your way of thinking. This is the core of the teaching of which I have protested. And it goes on. I personally, in my heart, if I search very deeply, because majority of the time is hidden, and or better, majority of the time, I don't listen to it. Maybe it's very well shown, but I just ignore it. In my heart, I believe these words are very much true. The key is that our spirituality, that for me does not take the name of any God, but on the contrary, is that spark that light my heart and make me listen to myself. Well, in India, you will all know that Brahma, in a certain point in your mythology, decided to hide the power of the man in the most secret place of all. Some gods told him, put in the highest mountain or in the deepest sea. And Brahma told, there will come one day in which man will very much be able to reach the deepest sea and the highest mountain. I will hide it in a place where he never look, that is his inner self. I believe now it's time the world put us in a time in which we have to go back to what we had abandoned for development, for be able to run together with the world, be able to be in the same level of the other part of the world. But now the world itself is telling us, go back of what you left behind. Because maybe the middle way that Buddhism talks about, the balance between the two, is the right solution to go, to step out from this present, not in a normality that we have left behind, but in a new normality that to me sounds much richer and much appropriate for the human being, that is not only outside, but is also inside, the part where we never look at. I would like, because I'm sure all of you feel the same, feel scared, and uncomfortable, and I would like to read a line that His Holiness the Dalai Lama wrote some years back, not for this situation, but I see it very much fit. No matter what is going on, never give up. Develop the art. Too much energy in your country is spent developing the mind instead of the art. Be compassionate, not just to your friends, but to everyone. Be compassionate. Work for peace in your heart and in the world. And I say again, never give up. No matter what's going on around you, never give up. The 14th Dalai Lama of Tibet. I would like to finish my talk with this sentence.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Matani. We have one question, in fact, one message from one student. Respected ma'am, I just want to say that I think hope plays an important role in this kind of situation. Suppose, as earlier government said, that we will remove lockdown on 14th. So people were happy and had a good on positive hope that we will be free from this virus. But that could not happen. So that's why people got in negative mindset. They did not get much positive energy to fight all stand together. So what he says that this might be a reason that people who so suffered from corona did diet as they do lost hope and their immune system got lowered.
Beautiful question, very appropriate.
Paola, before you answer the question, we probably would be disconnecting for 1 minute and rejoining so that you can answer some of the questions of the students. Right. Of course, my faculty colleagues around 15 minutes.
After 4
same
minutes.
Same ID and same password, right?
Right.
Okay.
Right.
Perfect.
If we get disconnected, please reconnect, right? We'll have some more time. You please begin your answer. Yeah.
I believe, and you're very right, that mental health and inner health is very much important also for physical health. In Latin, we say mens sana in corpore sano. That means an healthy mind in a healthy body. And to be honest, so yes, losing hope is something that does not help to recover. That's for sure. It's a well-known thing nowadays. But to be very honest, this disease is a real disease in any case. So please don't under-evaluate this. People doesn't die only because they lose hope. They die also because this disease is a really dangerous one and cannot be seen just as a normal flu. If not, the world won't be on lock. Everyone, India, Italy, Turkey, Europe, America, USA is under lock, not because they are losing hope, but because it's still a disease and people die from this disease. So please don't think that is something easy. Is something not to take in consideration. But yes, you're right at the same time. Mental well-being is very much necessary for recovering at the faster possible, in the faster way possible. And it's necessary because we must live in any situation we are, in any challenge of our life, in the best way possible, happy. All human beings look for happiness, seek happiness, or if not happiness, at least tranquility, serenity. Let's choose serenity as terminology to use here. So you must be able, even in a lockdown, even if this thing did extend, even if it didn't finish on 14th of April, but now it's still 4th of May, you have to be in any case happy. Try to find your serenity and don't see it coming from outside. It's not that your serenity will happen only because they open it up. I believe it's the right time. This time is the time in which the world is teaching us how to look serenity, not only from the things that happen outside, but from what is happening also inside. I hope I answered the best I could.
Yeah, there's another interesting question Paula, from my colleague. He says, Dr. Pankaj Agarwal, he says, what is your take on the conflict between living in the moment and having hope? Don't you think these are contradictory? So probably if it...
Very difficult question. So tell to your colleague, I'm going to mark down his name. And if I ever take a seminar, I'm going to prepare a very difficult question, but very interesting one as well. I believe not, because living the present is embracing whatever is not contradictory, because living the present is embracing any aspect of our life, is to be able to rejoice over it. And hope is the spark that let us walk ahead from this present. I believe